Welcome back everyone to theCUBE here in Washington, D.C. for AWS Public Sector Summit, D.C. Summit, all one thing. They call it the Amazon Web Services Summit. Kevin Miller, Vice President of Global Data Centers here. He's the star of the show, spending money like it's nobody's business, $30 billion in the past week. Got a lot of smiling, looking good, good to see you.
It's great to see you.
Welcome back.
Yeah, thanks for having me back.
So we're the 6 month almost halftime report for reInvent. Last 6 months ago, we talked the game. Now you deployed the big numbers, and there's more. That's just US.
Yes, $30 million in the last week, essentially, of announcements.
What's the big thing, and you got the international, what else is happening?
Well, I mean, I think when you look very broadly, we're deploying a lot of AI capacity. Of course, we've announced the coming availability of our P6 instances and continuing to scale up customers on Trainium. And so there's a lot, even though there's only been a few recent announcements, there's been a tremendous amount of work all year to really continue scaling up that AI infrastructure, frankly, at an unprecedented pace. And that's been pretty exciting, keeping the team very busy.
I spoke with Prasad, yes, last week, He laid out the systems designs, some air-cooled data centers coming, a lot of design.
And liquid cooled coming very
liquid
soon,
cooling.
Yes.
So a lot of action happening. What's the focus on selection, the demand side?
Yeah.
There's a lot of demand we hear. Come to my state, is there a luring going on? Are you guys actively looking? Can you give us a taste of what's happening?
Well, I mean, we're actually always looking, always developing options because, in the data center area, the timelines are actually, you have to think long-term because even if you have a parcel that's ready to go and has energy, it takes a while to construct the data center and you have to, when you're talking about building at the scale we are, which is hundreds of megawatts or gigawatts of capacity, you can't build that overnight. So you have to really be thinking long-term. So we're always kind of looking at what options exist, where we could go to add additional capacity. And we look for really a combination of where's energy available, where's their land available, and then also, very importantly, where is there the right kind of economic environment within a state or within a country to really support the growth and we, because we want to come in and really be partners in delivering, obviously what we need to meet our customer demand, but really also helping communities meet their interests. And so we're looking for that kind of partnership.
In terms of the curve of demand for AI compute,
yeah,
and where you guys are heading, let's say over the next 5 years, you feel you're getting ahead of that curve, or is it always going to be tracking? Or is that curve still to be defined, or with agentic AI and all this new stuff coming on board?
I mean, there's many curves. It's sort of a question of which curve,
counting clouds on a cloudy day.
Yeah, that's right, counting clouds on a cloudy day. So, we're adding capacity really at an unprecedented rate right now. And, we feel good about the capacity we have and that's coming online in the next year, year and a half. But it could be off. We could need more, and so we're always keeping a close eye on demand and looking for opportunities where, if we need to, we can expand.
When you guys look at the technology side, like power and cooling, we think we talked about that at reInvent. Are there new innovations? You mentioned liquid cooling.
Yeah.
What are some of the advancements you're seeing, and how does that affect the state or the region that you guys align with? Take me through that long-term process, because once you make the selection,
you're getting
married, basically.
Yeah, I mean, even, once we've chosen that we're going to build in a particular campus or a particular area, state, it doesn't, liquid cooling or the specific equipment that we're deploying in there doesn't really change the need to build a data center to do it. Now, certainly with AI computing, one of the things we're seeing is that the density of the racks is going way up, because the whole point of AI is you want to get as much GPU compute or accelerator compute in as small a physical space as you can. And so that really drives the densities up, which drives the need for liquid cooling. And so ultimately that may allow us to simplify the data centers in some way, but really right now our focus is on having flexibility to make sure that we can deploy whatever comes, because we have a rough idea of the designs 6 or 12 months from now, but we know that that's going to change. So.
It's a lot of work, because I won't say gamble, because there is probability theory involved here. Which processes will be available, supply chain, architectures.
That's right.
How do you guys handle that?
Well, I mean, I think it's the key is to maintain that flexibility and to know that, you know, when we think about the timeline to deploy something, we're always looking to reduce that timeline so that we can really make decisions as late as possible. You know, so we know we're going to build a data center and we can start doing that, but you know, what percent of liquid or what percent of air is it going to require? Our goal is to really push that decision making as late as possible because, you know, the later we go, the more certainty we have about exactly what's
going to be needed. Risk management's better.
That's right. So, you know, we're always just evaluating that and then just understanding as things change because they're changing every week.
What are some of the new technologies you guys are looking at in terms of energy?
Well, you know, of course, last year we were invested in X Energy as a Generation 4 small modular nuclear reactor company, and I think, you know, that's not going to happen overnight, but that is something that we think has a lot of promise to provide 24/7 baseload support on the grid long-term in a very safe environment. But of course, you know, we are the world's largest corporate purchaser of renewable energy, and continuing to buy solar and wind. We're also doing more with battery as well, and you know, we think that battery. You know, battery in the right places in the grid can really provide some really meaningful benefit, particularly at those sort of peak times of the day.
More than backup?
Provides, you know, support for the grid when it needs it the most, right?
Yeah.
When you've got
booster.
You know,
the peaks and valleys.
Mostly the peaks, right, is to be able to take care of when all the air conditioners are running on a hot summer day. You know, usually that peaks in the late afternoon, and if you provide a sort of a few hours of support, that can really change the dynamics quite a lot on the grid. So we're doing more with battery, and really just keeping our ear to the ground on, you know, on all the technologies that are emerging.
So you guys announced you're expanding your water recycling piece. Can you explain that a little further, what the stats are on that?
Yeah, we've started to really use recycled water in the U.S. especially. We have some pilot projects that we're starting to expand, particularly coming out of Virginia. And it's actually a technology, or it's an approach that we've used in other areas for a while, including in Singapore, where we've actually made use of what they call industrial water, which is really harvested rainwater, and also the outflow from sewage treatment plants, where it may not be potable water, it's not potable water, but it is perfectly acceptable for use in industrial operations. And so, you know, we take that water, we make sure it's clean and safe, and then we use it in the data center. And so it just avoids consuming potable water when you don't need to.
I mean, anyone who's played golf knows, we've seen when you go to the golf course, recycled water to get the grass to be green,
drink
it.
Yeah, no, you don't drink the water. but it's perfectly safe for use in the industrial context.
And you're doing this across dozens and dozens of sites, right?
Yeah, we will over time. I mean, we've got a number of pilots and we're expanding it now, and over time it'll be dozens of our
sites. You try different things at different sites in terms of pilots and try to get best practices?
We do, and one of the things to understand about our, you know, a data center is not just a data center. In some parts of the world, you know, we build entire treatment facilities to really clean the water, and in others we build like sewage treatment facilities to make sure that the water is safe to discharge. And so, you know, we have a pretty deep understanding of how to, you know, be responsible with water. Of course, we have our goal of being water positive by 2030, and so, you know, it's not one size fits all. In some areas, we're going to be able to use recycled water. In others, we do, you know, different things with water, but all towards that 2030 goal.
Define water positive for the audience?
It's essentially to return more water to communities, back than we consume in our operations. I mean, our data centers are actually very efficient at their use of water. It's something like 0.18 liters per kilowatt, which is really an industry leading in terms of the low amount of water use that we have. And in a lot of data centers, they use no water for the majority of the year. It's really the hottest days in the summer when they need water to reduce the incoming temperatures a bit. But actually, most of our buildings run most of the year where it's just using free air. There's no water involved, aside from drinking fountains.
Yeah, that's what I was getting to. All right, so your goals now going forward, you mentioned some of the ESG stats, 2030. Talk about the sustainability side of it and also the build-out side. What are some of your goals?
Well, you know, from sustainability, we remain very focused on our 2040 goal to be net zero carbon. And so that involves, that underpins a lot of our purchase of renewable energy and, you know, more than 28 gigawatts of renewable energy in wind and solar, as well as our investments in, you know, long-term carbon-free energy through things like our X Energy deal and our relationship with Energy Northwest to actually deploy small modular reactor in the state of Washington. And then, you know, so that's, I know on our sustainability goals, it's really about continuing to focus on that. We've also had done a number of work with reverse logistics and really doing as much as we can to harvest, you know, at this point, actually 99% of the parts that come out of our data center it's not waste. We actually recycle it and it gets either recycled directly into our servers as spare parts, or it gets handled responsibly in another way, recycled or reused. And so continuing to focus on that kind of circular economy type principle. And then outside of sustainability, you know, we're just continuing to deploy to keep pace with demand, make sure our customers can continue to scale and be successful.
What do you do every day when you wake up? You come up to the office, you sit around and say, you know, this place, how we do? Hey, we're doing good on sustainability. I mean, it's a huge task. Got a lot of people working on projects, economic models.
Yeah.
I mean, you have a huge staff. I'm kind of just making a little over the top to make a point, but it's complicated.
Yeah, that's right.
Can you frame the scope, magnitude?
No 2 days are ever different, but when you're talking about deploying gigawatts of capacity around the world in a given year, as well as making progress on all of these goals, it does require, you know, to stay really attuned to the data. You know, we have data from all various data sources, and it's actually one of the interesting things we're doing within my organization, data center organization, is, you know, we talk in a lot of AWS services about building data lakes and really tapping into that data for AI. We're doing that. We are actually, you know, this year I asked my teams recently to come up with all of the areas that we're using AI to improve what we do day to day. And the, you know, last year the team had maybe two or three items. This year it was 2 pages. And I had to actually prune some of the items off when I'm sort of summarizing it. And so it's across the board from working with our general contractors and giving them RFI responses faster because we have Gen AI giving, learning from what we've said previously. It's that to, you know, tapping into our data lake that we've assembled across my entire org to make, you know, better decisions and better insights about, you know, where do we need to optimize a particular data center. When you have a fleet of, you know, hundreds of data centers, there, at any given time you might have one that is doing really good and others that may not be doing so good, and what lessons can we learn from the way these are operating well to make sure that the whole fleet can operate effectively.
Do you envision agents, AI agents, agentic systems being able to do that?
100%, absolutely. I mean, this year we'll have agents that are doing that, whether it's, you know, optimizing based on, you know, metrics from the data centers, or just helping decision making around, you know, our renewable energy projects. There's just so many facets where, at the scale we operate, you know, we can absolutely have agents have a huge benefit to the day to day.
You see it becoming more and more autonomous as years roll by.
I think for
always
some,
human in the loop, or
I think for some things it will actually absolutely become, you know, more autonomous. And we, you know, our data centers actually already have control systems that we've specially designed, but they are autonomous. So, for example, if we have a power outage in a data center, the control system is automatically reconfiguring the electrical distribution in a data center without any human being involved. And so there's already a degree of autonomy, but I think we can take it to the next level by then applying AI systems. And obviously we have to do it safe and carefully, but that's all given. Like, we will do that.
Yeah.
You have mechanisms, you have workflows and mechanisms, you know. So
absolutely,
you can have agents do that.
Right, we can have agents take well-trodden paths where we already know the guardrails, and we can be very, you know, confident that they're going to be successful.
All right, what's an area that you're excited about this year?
Well, I mean, I think the rapid advancement of AI is hard to undersell. And so, you know, everything I just talked about, it actually is really fun for me to be able to see how, yeah, we're deploying a lot of the capacity, but we're also able to really make use of it to be more efficient, to be able to deploy more predictably. And so, you know, really it's a flywheel that's helping us, helping our customers.
Yeah, and Roger was just on talking about the economics, almost like a planned community. We're going to have a data center, all this impact.
Oh yeah.
But it's really first generation, large scale for a lot of these states to have a major technology enabler.
That's right.
I mean, your regions were really well intentionally picked.
That's right, and increasingly, as we just announced in Pennsylvania, I mean, it's quite rural, right? And it also, when we announced in South Bend last year, you know, South Bend isn't quite as rural, but it's still largely in sort of an agricultural community, and University of Notre Dame's there, of course, too. But those communities, and one of the things I think about is, for these communities, data centers are really bringing in a source of dollars that are coming in outside, you know, and not just, it's not just then dollars kind of circulating within a local economy, it's actually a credible source of new dollars, you know, continuing to come into those communities. And so I think there's just a lot of development, you know, that can be done there.
How much of your time are you spending on regulatory issues? Is that a more or less? Do you hope it goes down?
Well, I have an amazing team that actually, a public policy team that works night and day. Shannon Kellogg and his team are amazing. But you know, certainly things are changing rapidly, not just in the U.S., but as you think about what's happening in Europe and the reaction to, you know, both what's happening in the U.S. as well as changes in Europe that are happening in terms of the governing and governments
but
there.
But Kevin, you're open for business right now. You're in business development mode. You're
absolutely.
You're in growth.
That's right, like and we work with governments to be successful in doing that. Yeah.
So take me through that targeting. You're open for business, there's a little criteria involved. What's the selection criteria as you do business? Has that changed at all this past year? Has it opened up wider in terms of doing business with your data centers?
One of the things I say is actually that, you know, one of the best things that that helps us in being successful is when we have a government that's really engaged and interested in having us grow and really puts people on point to help us drive all the various agencies. Because in every government, it doesn't matter, I mean, the names might be different, the exact functions might be owned in different places, but every government has, you know, multiple departments that all have to be involved, you know, from a construction, environmental review, you know, economic development point of view. And so having people that are really on point to help coordinate across the whole of government to make these projects be successful and move at pace is incredibly valuable to us.
So orchestration.
It's an
operating system.
That's right, and just knowing
agents will do well there.
Yeah. And just knowing that it's a focal area can be incredibly helpful.
Create the bid.
I mean, someday it might be an agent to do that, but you know, who knows, we'll see.
Kevin, great to have you on theCUBE, and again, congratulations on the 30 billion news that hit. It was super exciting. 20 in Pennsylvania and 10 in North Carolina.
That's right. It's been fun.
Onward and upward.
And more to do. So thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming on.
Yep.
Bringing down the story, really, you know, an expansion in modern era of infrastructures coming all over the United States and around the world. We haven't even get into sovereign cloud. We'll wait for in July to talk about that. But again, it's all changing here in DC. It's theCUBE bringing it to you. Thanks for watching.